So in this section, we're going to talk about spent fuel radiation. And there are three types of spent fuel radiation: gamma radiation, Cherenkov radiation, and neutron radiation. So let's start with gamma radiation and take a look at a spent fuel gamma radiation spectrum. And this comes from a 32 gigawatt per metric ton burn-up assembly with 9-month cooling time. So you see various different fission product activities and structural activation products. We'll point out the structural activation products here because they're short-lived and those will go away within 1 or 2 years. Then let's focus on the cesium-137 gamma ray here. And we'll note that the cesium-137 gamma ray activity is about 10 to the 7 times greater than U-235 or plutonium-239 gamma ray activities. And what this means is that you're never going to see the uranium-235 or plutonium-239 gamma rays on a spectrum. The uranium and plutonium gamma radiation are completely masked by fission product gammas. So now let's take a look quickly at the axial profile of gamma ray activities, and we'll focus specifically on the cesium-137 gamma ray activity. In this figure, you have the cesium-137 peak intensity on the vertical axis as a function of the vertical detector position alongside the spent fuel assembly from bottom to top on the horizontal axis. And you'll see the curve shape there, which shows that the greatest intensity of gamma rays comes from the center of the fuel assembly. And that makes sense because the most fissions occur during reactor operation at the center of the fuel assembly, and there are less fissions that occur towards the ends. So now let's take a look at Cherenkov radiation, and a good, great question is, what is Cherenkov radiation? We see an image here of a spent fuel assembly, and Cherenkov radiation is that blue glow, that blue characteristic glow that you see from spent fuel. But what specifically is Cherenkov radiation? The definition is light emitted when a charged particle exceeds the speed of light of a dielectric medium, like water, that the particle is passing through. You can't exceed the speed of light in a vacuum, but you can exceed it in different media. And so if a particle is moving too fast, it has to radiate out energy, and it does that through Cherenkov radiation. So there are several sources of Cherenkov radiation in spent fuel. The first is beta radiation, and betas are just electrons that are emitted, and so they produce Cherenkov radiation directly. Other indirect sources of Cherenkov radiation include neutron radiation and gamma radiation. And as it turns out, the most significant source of Cherenkov radiation comes from the gammas indirectly. So let's take a look at that process specifically. So if we start with a spent fuel rod or spent fuel assembly, gamma ray is emitted, and it has an interaction with an electron belonging to water or a structural material atom. And the interaction that it has is a Compton scatter, and the gamma scatters off and continues with a new energy and wavelength, but the electron is ejected. And as I said before, it's ejected with too much energy. It's moving too quickly through the water, so it has to radiate out the extra energy. And as it does that, as it moves through the water, this Cherenkov light is emitted. And it actually happens similar to a shock wave, like if a supersonic jet, when it exceeds the speed of sound in air, produces a sonic boom. This is like kind of like a light boom. So the important thing to take away, though, is that Cherenkov radiation is proportional to gamma radiation. So next, let's take a look at the spent fuel neutron radiation. We have a figure here showing the neutron radiation of the most active neutron emitters in spent fuel. On the vertical axis, we have the relative neutron emission rate in a logarithmic scale, and the horizontal axis is cooling time. So As time progresses, of course, these radioactive neutron emitters are decaying. So we see five principal neutron emitters. That's two isotopes of curium, curium-244 and 242, and then three isotopes of plutonium, 240 and 238 and 242. So what you see here is that the neutron emissions are totally dominated by the curium. At the beginning, it's dominated by both the curium-244 and curium-242, but then the curium-242 dies away pretty quickly. It has a short half-life. So that drops out, and then the total neutron emission activity is completely represented almost by the curium-244. So again, what we see here is that the plutonium signal is completely dominated by the higher actinide curium. So then if we take a look at the axial distribution of neutron activity, again, you see the same thing that we saw with the gamma ray activity. In this figure, we have neutron counts on the vertical axis and vertical position from bottom to top on the horizontal axis. And you see this curve with the peak intensity in the middle, which indicates that the most fissions occurred in the middle of the fuel, which, as we know from before, is the way it works. So let's look at gamma radiation versus neutron radiation. We'll take a look at a couple things here. First point that we'll make here is the source of the radiation within the fuel assembly. The gamma radiation comes that you see outside the fuel assembly comes primarily from the fuel rods at the edge of the assembly. The attenuation within the fuel assembly is high for gamma rays. So if they're emitted in the center of the fuel assembly, they're not going to make it to the outside. So when you take a look at the gamma radiation signal, what you're really looking at is just the outer fuel rods of the fuel assembly, and you're not getting any information or any radiation from the inner fuel rods of the assembly. Neutrons, however, travel much farther through the fuel assembly than the gamma rays. They're attenuated much less. So you will see neutrons that come from central fuel rods all the way to the outside of the fuel assembly. The next thing we'll take a look at is the source material of the radiation. We mentioned before that gamma rays come from both the fuel, the cladding, and other structural materials within the fuel assembly. And so you're getting radiation from two sources there, the fuel and the structural materials. The structural material radiation is short-lived, but it's still there at the beginning. The neutrons are coming only from the fuel. So these two factors, the assembly source location and source material of the radiation, provide several advantages and disadvantages we'll take a look at. So for the neutrons, you can measure neutron radiation almost immediately after spent fuel discharge. With the gamma radiation, you'll get a lot of the structural activation products radiation that isn't so much useful for looking at examining the spent fuel, as we'll talk about later. And also, neutrons have the advantage that the signal is from all the fuel rods. It's from the central fuel rods, it's from the outer fuel rods. The gamma radiation is just from the outer fuel rods. However, there are some disadvantages for neutrons. Neutron detectors are sensitive to gamma rays, so you have to take that into account when you're doing interrogation of the fuel assembly, at least non-fission chamber neutron detectors. And there are some other advantages and disadvantages that depend on radiation signatures that we'll take a look at a little later. One other thing I'd like to mention here is neutron radiation with active interrogation. Passive interrogation just means observing spent fuel with a radiation detector. So you just put a radiation detector beside the fuel assembly and see what you read. For neutron radiation, that passive interrogation will give you a signal mainly from curium isotopes and the spontaneous fission within those curium isotopes. With active interrogation, you introduce an external neutron source, and that external source basically shoots neutrons into the fuel assembly, and you get fissions from the uranium-235 and plutonium-239. So you get many more neutrons, one, and you also get a neutron signal from your uranium-235 and plutonium-239 with active interrogation that you don't see when you do passive interrogation.